A very good morning, dear children. We are doing chapter 1, Resources and Development from Geography. I request you all to be ready with your textbooks in your hand and even the pencil so that you can simultaneously mark in the textbook whatever are the important points and important lines too. We were doing a session on classification of resources. This is the second part of that. Today, we will be starting with the classification of resources on the basis of ownership. Ownership, obviously, belongingness. We have four types in that. First one, individual. Second, community. Third, national and international. Or in other words, we can also say that resources which belong to or resources which are used by an individual, by a group of community, by the complete nation, or maybe by more than one country. It is on the basis of usage this particular resource or this particular division is being done. As we know, resources definition itself says resources which we are using in order to satisfy our needs. Hence, whoever is using this resource will decide the ownership of that particular resource. We start with the very first, individual resources. Individual resources can be of various types. It can be our house, it can be the car, it can be any type of resource, maybe a farmland, maybe a well. Likewise, the individual resources are there. But even though the resources are individual, they are belonging to us only on one condition, and that is against the payment of revenue or the tax to the government. Whether the resource is individual, it belongs to us, but then we have to pay the tax for this to the government. We have the next division, community resources or community owned resources. These resources, obviously, which are used by the community, we can see a grazing land, there can be the gardens, there can be the hospital, it can be a temple, it can be many other places, of course. As in the textbook, they have given you many places, villages, it can be ponds, they can be picnic spots also, even the burial grounds. Now, these are all used by the community. Again, the same law applies over here. These also belongs to the community or to the society against the payment of revenue or the tax to the government. Against the payment of revenue, it means we have to pay the tax to the government. If we do not pay the tax, the things or the belongingness of that resource by us will be lost. We have a third type of resource, and that is national resources. If you will see the textbook, they have given the very first line, technically. All the resources, they belong to the nation. Whether it is individual resource, whether it is community resource, but all the resources, they belong to the nation. Hence, that is also one thing, that we are using the national resource, hence we have to pay the tax. Now, how all the national resources or how all the resources belong to the nation? Because if you will see the book, the country has legal powers. The government can actually legally acquire whatever resources belongs to us. They can also take the private resources or community resources for the public good. Public good, like if you have to construct any kind of railway stations or something, in that case, definitely the land of the privately owned person also can also be taken. Like the construction of Golden Quadrilateral, or you can say the better example in Nagpur when the metro construction was done. So metros are not used by particular one person, it is for the complete public. And hence, in that case, whosoever's private land came in between the plan that was taken and the remunerations were given to them. Hence, we call technically all the resources, they belong to the nation. Because any resource can be taken by the private or by the community, by the government, they can take us. We have, if I want to define, over the land resource. Within the land boundary, whichever resources are found, they all called as natural resources. In that, we can have a river, we can have the minerals, we can have the forest also. Whichever resources are there within the nation, they all are called as the natural resources. Natural resources, it means the country can use them. This is regarding the land, over the land I am talking about, or inside the boundaries on the land we are talking about. We move on to the next resource, and that is international resources. International resources, here again I am talking about over the land actually. Over the land, if any land piece or any land mass which is actually not used or not claimed by any particular one country, then it is called as a international resource. In other words, if any place on the earth is used by more than one country, it will be an international resource. We have a best example of that, and that is Antarctica. Antarctica, it's not belonging to any one country. Over the Antarctica, you have many countries' research centers, and we all are trying to utilize it for the further or for the future generations actually. So over the land, whoever is the user, that will be termed accordingly: private, community, national and international. But over the oceans, the national as well as international resources, they have some kind of specifications. Now, international resources, open oceans, they are there. We can also have exclusive economic zones, which can be also the international resources. Whereas over the oceans, the national properties can be the territorial waters. Let us understand this more. If I take from the land or from the coastal line towards the sea, that is inside the sea. Now, from the land, it means from the coastal line. From the coastal line till the 12 nautical miles, it means 22.2 kilometers distance. If you go inside the oceans, these particular set of waters, they are considered as territorial waters. Territorial water, it means territorial sea. That means the country, whoever is having that particular boundary, can share all the resources, can use all the resources. They can have the constructions also over there, and they can use it for their economic development. These are our waters. And remember, territorial sea, territorial water, this is a national resource. Moving on to the next, international resource over the oceans. Again, from here, the picture says, which is shown to you, exclusive economic zone, and in the bracket they are showing up to 200 nautical miles from the baseline. Now obviously, from the baseline, it means again from the coastal region. Again, from the coastal region, which includes even the territorial sea, from there till the 200 nautical miles, this particular section will be called as exclusive economic zone. Exclusive economic zone has a name specifically given to that. It is basically an economic zone. Why? So that people belonging to this particular country can use it for their economic development, such as extraction of minerals can be done, extraction of oil also can be done. The only thing, exclusive economic zone is basically an international resource. Exclusive economic zone has certain rules and regulations to be followed. The rules and regulations generally belongs to the, or generally they are of the type of pollution control measures. Now obviously a question comes, why the territorial sea area is also included in exclusive economic zone? Some rules are relaxed in the territorial sea, but the pollution norms, they have to be applied even in the territorial waters and even in the exclusive economic zone. Because if the water is polluted in the territorial region, it will definitely affect the exclusive economic zone water also. Hence, exclusive economic zone has strict rules and regulations which has to be followed right from the territorial sea. The only one simple difference I'll be able to tell you over here, it has many things, but then just to note, territorial sea we can have some constructions of our own also, but in the exclusive economic zone we are not allowed to do any constructions and all. We are just allowed to use the resources because we have such a huge big coastal line and our number of population depend upon that particular zone. And hence, by the international resources, this resource is given to us for the usage. Now, like this, every country, whoever is having a coastal line, they all have such kind of exclusive economic zone. Definitely, somewhere the calculations are differing. Over India, we have, these are the calculations. We have 12 nautical miles territorial sea. We have 200 nautical miles exclusive economic zone. Now, after 200 nautical miles, we have the high sea. High sea over here, but the textbook says open oceans. It means after exclusive economic zone, whichever oceans will be remaining, they all called as the open oceans and they purely belong to the international resources. Not a single country can use the open oceans unless and until 2 to 3 countries come together and they utilize it for their purpose. So over the oceans, this is the way actually we have the distribution of resources. Now, in case of India, basically, in case of India, Lakshadweep definitely might be coming into our exclusive economic zone. But Andaman and Nicobar is not a part of our exclusive economic zone. Andaman and Nicobar, they have open oceans in between and separately they have their own territorial water and even that is having their own separate exclusive economic zone. Now one more thing, the yellow box in the textbook, that is do you know box. India has got the right to mine the manganese nodules from the bed of the Indian Ocean. And that lies which beyond the exclusive economic zone, that means from the open oceans, India is extracting certain things. Now why India has got this right? Because such kind of division should be there over the oceanic resources was demanded by few countries earlier. And India was among the first 10. So India has got that special right. Right? Here we clear or we end up with the ownership, that is how the resources are divided on the basis of ownership. Moving on to the next one, that is on the basis of status of its development. Status of development, it means how much developed that particular resource is. Is there any possibility to develop more or are we using it properly or not? Likewise, level of development. In what status of development basically the resources? We have 4 categories in this. We have potential resource, we have developed resource, we have stock and we have the reserve. The very first, potential resource. Now potential word itself tells some capacity within. It means that there is still some scope to develop for these resources. Like we have the example of solar and wind energy. Solar and wind energy, if you will see, in India, we have bright prospects, especially Gujarat side, especially you can see Rajasthan side. We can use this enormously, but we are not using them properly. The word properly defines it very clearly. Everywhere, if you will see the textbook, resources which are found in a region but are not being utilized. So we have to add a word over there and that is not used properly basically. Reasons can be n number. We are not here to discuss those reasons right now. Only thing, this is a kind of resource which we have the technology, which we have started using, but we are not using to its fullest. It has still some potential. The next resource, that is developed resource. Developed, it means fully developed. Now we cannot add anything in that. It is working properly and it is fully developed. We have a very good example of that which is not given in the textbook which you will be including in your textbook, and that is Damodar Valley project. Damodar Valley project, here the river Damodar is given. originates from Jharkhand and then drains into the Bay of Bengal through the West Bengal. Now the river was known, as we have studied last year, River of Sorrow, because it was having lots of floods. What they have done? They have made a project on that. It means they have practically made many reservoirs and the dams on that. You will see the dark colored places. These are the dams and the reservoirs. Obviously, excessive water is getting collected in that. Altogether, they have constructed 12 dams. And these 12 dams, they are using for collecting excessive water, which has definitely controlled the floods. Moreover, these dam water, they are using for agriculture, so their agriculture is also flourished. Most of the dams are also the hydro power plant, so obviously it means they are having the hydroelectricity also. So they have all the raw material to develop the industrial region, so the region is industrially also developed. So it is just one creation of resource, and that is the DVC, that is Damodar Valley project, has developed this complete region, and hence this is an example of a developed resource. We have the next, that is stock. Obviously stock, something tells you that which we have kept for the future. Now stock, here a difference is there, a slight difference. From the textbook you will underline, we do not know the appropriate technology. It means we know that there are some things or certain things in the nature which can become a resource, but we don't know how. We are not having the technology. The best example, uranium, which is found in Ladakh, we have. So this, we know that the resource is there, but we don't know how to take it out. So it is a stock. Whenever in the future the technology will be discovered, it will become a developed resource, or it can become a potential resource also. Another example which is given in the textbook, that H2O, water is a combination of two particular highly inflammable gases, hydrogen and oxygen. We know the process of combining them, but we don't know the process of separating them. So again, we are not knowing how to separate these two things from the water so that we can use them as an energy resource in the future. So stock is definitely used for the future whenever the technology will be used. So stock we are keeping for the future, not by our wish, but it is actually forcibly, because we don't know the technology. The next we have is the reserve. Now reserve, obviously again for the future generation, but here a difference is there. Here the difference is this, that we know the technology. We know everything, how to use it, where to use it and all. But we are purposely not using it, because we want it to keep it for the future generation. Like for example, if a river site is identified for a dam, but we are purposely not constructing a dam on that, because we want to get it utilized for the future generation. So if I want to differentiate between the stock and the reserve, then definitely they both are for the future generation. But one is forcibly kept for the future generation, whereas the other one is purposely kept for the future generation. In the stock, we don't know the technology, whereas in reserves, we know the technology. And then third point can be a example, of course, example properly explained in the textbook they have given. This is where we actually end up with this classification of resources. Next topic which we have, that is resource development. If I go ahead with resource development, we have development wise, they have just given some little importance. Here the very first line, resources are vital for human survival. Definitely you have to bracket it and put a justification remark, that you have to justify that how resources are useful for the human beings. Obviously our human life is possible only because of the resources. So you all will be writing different resources which the human being used to live. So this is the answer. After that, we move on to the next thing, that is the last line. Here they say that human beings use the resources indiscriminately. Indiscriminately, it means we were having, as you all aware that earlier human being was thinking that resources are the free gift of nature. So let's use it. And then he started using it indiscriminately. But that has created some problems. And these three problems, very important question. We will underline the keywords in that. And here the very first will be depletion of resources. It means the resources started depleting. I'm just telling you the keywords. You will write the keywords as the heading and then remaining things as the explanation points. But writing three bulleted points with the underlined words, that is most important. That covers the whole thing. Second problem is that, if I want to underline, divided the society into two segments, and these two segments, rich and the poor. So that was one major effect of the indiscriminate use of resources. Some were getting many resources, some were not at all getting resources. So obviously the gap between rich and poor has increased. The next one, or the last one, you can say the keyword will be global ecological crisis. So because of this, global ecological crisis has aroused, and these kind of crisis examples, global warming, ozone layer depletions and all. So this is 1 3-mark question. We have one small question which starts with an equitable distribution of resources. It means the resources should be equally distributed. Now you will be finding the points from this. It is says that if everyone starts getting the resources, quality of life will increase, even global peace will also be there. Hence, equal distribution of resources has to be there. You have the very correct definition of sustainable development here. If you will see, it says development should take place, definitely, but without damaging the environment. Till now, whatever development we had that had damaged the environment, that was only development. But if we want to fit us into the development definition, then it should not harm the environment. Plus, whatever development we are doing today, it should not compromise with the needs of the future generation. So within this definition, whichever developments are going on, they all will be termed as sustainable development, and this is the time's need today actually. That sustainable development is important, not only development. The next thing which we have, Rio de Janeiro and Agenda 21, we will be seeing and learning it afterwards, but you will just give a reading to that. Right now, we are not going to touch this topic. We have next topic, that is resource planning. Obviously, if you want the equal distribution of resources, it has to have the planning. So what is this planning? It is basically a widely accepted strategy for the judicious use of resources. Right now, judicious use is not going on, indiscriminate use is going on. Anybody is using anything like anyhow actually. So we want to make that resource justified, judicious, and that technique should be widely accepted by the people also. So this is what is the resource planning definition. Now why do we need it in India? So here you have one condition or some kind of conditions in India. You will find here in this particular question or in this particular paragraph that why resource planning is needed in India. So very first line says, very first point, India has enormous diversity in the availability of resources. It's not that we are not having any resources, we have multiple resources, and that too diversified. We have seen last year that how we have different resources at different places, and in order to distribute them properly, obviously you require the planning. Now, how the resources are distributed in India? So the point number 2 says, you will be finding 4 words in this paragraph. That is, there are regions which are, first, rich, encircle that. Second, deficient, encircle that. The third, that is self-sufficient, encircle that. And the last, that is acute shortages. We have these 4 types of regions in India.
Some resources, some regions are resource rich, some regions are deficient, some regions are self-sufficient, whereas some regions are having acute shortages. Now, in such kind of situation, obviously you require the resource planning. Now, you have to prove this, that how we have rich, sufficient, self-sufficient, acute shortages existing in our country. So, from the following examples, you will pick up any three examples and you are going to write down that. You all are aware of these things, like Rajasthan is very good in solar energy and wind energy, but they are deficient in water. Ladakh, rich in culture and all, but yes, again, it is having deficiency of water infrastructure and other minerals also. If you will see Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, they are rich in minerals, coals and all. Likewise, you have to find out four examples or three examples. And because we have such a situation in India, we require resource planning in India. So this is why resource planning is required in India. We have the next thing, that is how resource planning is done in India. Again, the three steps, it is not an easy process, it is a complex process. Hence, they call it as a resource planning, a complex process. Now, how do we plan the resources in India? Very first, identification and inventory of resources. If it is a mineral site, if it is a river site, we will identify that. But if it is a research work, maybe a technology has to be invented, maybe a research work has to be done, so then that will be an invention. So first we will either identify a resource or invent a resource. This will be your key line. How do they do that? Surveying, mapping, qualitative and quantitative estimation. We have a second thing. After identification, we will have or we will prepare a planning structure. Now, what we will do in the planning structure? We will see which technology is applied, which skill people are required, what kind of institutional setup is required. It means how many laborers I will require, what kind of machines I will be requiring, how much will be my budget and all. So, if I have identified any resource, I will prepare a planning structure also of that with my budget ready. Lastly, I will match that particular resource developmental plan with the national developmental plan. Like every country with their 5-year plans, they have variety of plans basically. So it has to be matched with the national developmental plan. Like for example, in Nagpur we were having Mihans project very long back, of course, but it was not started or it was not working properly and all. It got its sanctioning only when it matched with the government's actually criteria. So when the government has started, okay, IT is our, IT sector development is one of our criteria. So my resource and their plan match, and hence the work has started. So this is how, these are the three steps before we plan any resource or before we construct any resource. Another example, if I'll give you. If I have identified a river site, the second step, I will evolve a structure. And in that structure, what will I do? I'll see how much big dam can be constructed, how much laborers will be required, what will be the budget and all. And my things are ready. I want to construct a hydropower plant. I have submitted my planning to the government. Government is also having a plan of electricity problem. So it has matched with the governmental plan and government has given a sanctioning to that, and I have started construction of hydropower plant. So likewise, we have divisions in the government, we have resource developmental plan divisions and all. Likewise, they work on developing the resources. This section is how the resource planning is done in India, whereas the previous one was, that was why. We have this section, you will just go through this section. This section is nothing but it is teaching us that when the Britishers, they came to India, obviously at that time also we were having lots and lots of resources. The only thing which we were missing, and that was technology, education, knowledge. but they were having that, and they have utilized our resources with their technology. Hence, this section acts as a warning to us that having resources is not sufficient. It should also have the technology and the educated people also. Otherwise, the history will repeat, right? And the last section, we have conservation of resources. Now, here we will just see what is the conservation of resources. Obviously, to save the resources for the future generation. When we will start actually doing the resources, we will be studying the actual conservation of resources. Here only some views are explained. That if you do not consume the resources or conserve the resources, obviously the future generation will be in the problem and all. Here they have given us Mahatma Gandhiji's views on resource conservation. He had presented three important views definitely, in which his first thing was this: there is enough for everybody's need, but not for anybody's greed. If somebody is needy, or if all are needy, and if everyone takes whatever they need, definitely there is sufficient. But even if you get one single greedy person, then the resources will definitely not be sufficient. So yes, according to him, greedy people, the second thing he opined that he placed the greedy and selfish individuals, and not only that, exploitative nature of the modern technology at the root cause of resource depletion. Imagine if a greedy person gets the help of technology, then obviously how much he will exploit, because technology gives you a hand to get maximum use out of that particular resource. So it means there is nothing for a greedy person, and if the greed is there, resources are definitely not sufficient. Moreover, if you are putting the technology, but then technology also should be equally distributed. It should not be only for the fulfillment of the greed. And last, his statement was, he was against the mass production and wanted to replace it with the production done by masses. It means mass production, huge production. Now, who is doing this huge production? One person. If one person is doing huge production, he was not in favor of that. Whereas he want to replace it with production done by masses. Many people should produce a lot. In this, what will happen? Resources are equally distributed. All are getting their proper share and all. So these are the views of Mahatma Gandhiji regarding resource conservation. So, I'll be giving you the assignment. Definitely, I have given this time much time for you to write that assignment and all. Any problem or any doubt, you will be posting on the group or maybe on my personal WhatsApp number. Thank you.